The worst question you can ever ask is, how do I have a better marriage? Because it takes two. The best question is, God, how can I be a better husband? How can I be a better wife? What is within my control?
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, I've said it many times, but there is one thing that we are core about, and that's marriage. I mean, that's one of our core things. We want marriages to thrive. We want them to thrive in Christ, ideally. And we do place a high emphasis on the institution of marriage because we believe in it. We believe it's God's design for the family. And I know, hearing from the listeners and the viewers, they agree. I mean, that's why they're tuning in. They want to get some help. They want to have a better marriage. Gene and I want to do that. We're learning every day. But I really get so much wisdom, as you do, John, through listening to the guests that we have the privilege of interviewing. Yeah. And that's going to be the same today. I'm excited to interview two of our colleagues.
Yeah, Greg Smalley and Bob Paul join us. Greg is the Vice President of Marriage here at Focus on the Family and has been here a number of times. Bob heads up our Hope Restored Marriage Intensives. And we'll talk a little bit more about those as we go. Together, they have a brand new book called 9 Lies That Will Destroy Your Marriage and the Truths That Will Save It and Set It Free. It's published by Focus on the Family. And of course, we have that here. Click the link at the bottom of your screen.
Greg and Bob, welcome to Focus.
Hey, thank you. It's so good to be with you guys.
You've been here a few times, Greg. Bob, this is your first time.
First time on the broadcast.
Yeah, it's so good to have you. And you're normally out in Missouri at Branson and
that's correct.
Helping couples every day, right?
Absolutely. Hope Restored. Absolutely. There and in Georgia and in Michigan. So I'm all over the place for Focus.
Talk about Hope Restored. Just fill in what happens there. People arrive, couples arrive Sunday night typically.
Yeah, it's a program that we have, as you know, for couples that are struggling and generally in pretty severe crisis. They show up for our mainstay, which is our group program. They show up Sunday night. And then they're there through the day on Thursday, and they come often looking for a miracle. It's all day long, so we can really get deep. We've got people, staff involved to be able to care for them so they don't have to worry about all the normal things. They don't have to cook. They don't have to clean. They don't have to deal with all the stressors, the normal stressors of life. And we can really help them stay with the issue till we get to the core. And when we get to the core, that's where the Holy Spirit really shows up and real deep healing occurs. Matter of fact, we have people tell us regularly that an intensive is like a year to a year and a half's worth of normal therapy.
Yeah, and it's so exciting. And for those couples who are really struggling, those that are in great difficulty, this is the kind of thing. If you're in that last knot in your marriage rope, give this a try. So many couples get turned around in this environment. And this program has an 80% post-2-year success rate, meaning 80% of those couples are together and doing better. 97% satisfaction rating that couples come and that the experience exceeds their expectations. 97%. And the bottom line is you'll go away healthier. Regardless of what happens in your marriage, you'll be a healthier person. But the best thing is that 80% factor. All right, let's turn to the book and talk about what you've discovered in your practices, etc. One is just marriage in general. When you look at the culture, there seems to be, because of the, the divorce rate and people's disillusionment with marriage, the culture generally is pulling back. You have some in the culture saying we need to do away with the nuclear family. I think it's crazy. I think it's the beginning of the problems in the culture that we don't have healthy, intact families. But what's your read of why the culture is pulling back from the institution of the family? Where did the institution come from and why is it under attack?
You know, God created marriage. So man did not. It was God's gift to us in thus, it's opposed. And so the evil one, Satan, hates marriage, hates what it stands for. And I really believe a big part of what's going on in our culture right now is that Satan is so committed to destroy marriage because he fears what our marriage could be. When you have a husband and wife together, figuring out how can we use this gift that God's given us to serve others, to love others. That is one of the most powerful forces on earth. And Satan knows that. And so he tries to create chaos. He wants couples to buy into lies that they start trying to live out that completely then destroys their marriage. And that's what Bob and I see when couples come in for an intensive. They've bought into lies. They want a great marriage. They're these lies though exist, these myths, and they don't get them there at all. And I really believe it's because Satan is trying to create that chaos because he fears what we could be.
Well, and I love that spiritual application of that, the idea that when a couple is functioning in God's design, that it's powerful and it brings shalom, it brings peace to the family, to the community, to the church. I mean, it's what God intends for us. And boy, our flesh and Satan work overtime to separate us and keep us apart.
And you know, what's really interesting too, as we see these couples coming in, is that the lies have not only infiltrated our culture. Satan knows what he's doing, and they have infiltrated the church.
Oh, yeah.
And we are being told things and given strategies for doing relationships by well-meaning people who really aren't out to hurt us, who really believe what they're teaching us. And these strategies cannot work. They are not in line with God's design, and the couples don't know it. So what we see happening frequently is that couples are doing the things they were told they should do that should result in a good marriage, and it's not working. But they've been told by people that they trust. So when they don't work, what do you think they're left to assume is the problem? Well, they start pointing to each other. Well, it must be there's something wrong with me, or I got a defective spouse. And the people are virtually never the problem. It's that they're trying to use relational strategies that cannot succeed, and they don't realize
it. It's going right back to the garden. That's so amazing that Adam and Eve were the first ones to demonstrate unhealthy relationships.
That's right.
She made me do it. No, he did it. You know.
It was Satan's deception.
Right.
That caused it.
Okay, let's get to we're going to try to cover the nine today and tomorrow. I don't know that we'll get to all nine, but if you miss any of the program, make sure you download it. John will give those details in a minute, but let's get to the first one. In fact, you share the story of Zach and Katie, who added to their wedding vows, and they lived happily ever after at their ceremony. That fairy tale idea, that's the first lie. So take a whack at it.
You know, it's interesting that that whole fairy tale view of marriage has so infiltrated our Western culture for sure. And the idea when you get married is you're hoping that, you know, it starts once upon a time. And certainly the love that I have right now for my spouse has to be leading toward, and they all lived happily ever after. And happiness isn't a bad thing. I mean, frankly, I'm kind of partial to happy, and I prefer more than less. I'm convinced God wants us to be happy. But when you think that happiness is the key, that happiness is the goal, you are so set up, because obviously God put us here on purpose with purpose. And there's a cosmic battle that's going on between good and evil. And happiness can't be the primary goal. There's a purpose bigger than happiness.
Okay, but in that, where are we getting those signals? The media? What? How come, A, it's not bad to have a bar to be reaching for? I want a happy, joyful marriage. I think that's okay. Where does that break down to where it becomes a lie, Greg?
Yeah, the lie is that my end in mind is to feel happy. Versus when I think about my marriage, I think about Aaron and I on this grand adventure. We're on a journey. My goal isn't to be happy. My goal is to journey in this life with Aaron.
Through all the valleys and the mountaintops.
Through all of that. And because if my goal is happiness, then what happens when we're not happy? What happens when we're in pain and we're frustrated and something's going on? It's so confusing. As Bob said, then maybe it's me. Maybe she's the problem.
Versus, I wouldn't go there.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that out loud. I'm just in my mind, I'm thinking that. But what I love when the goal is to be on a journey with my wife, 1 Corinthians 7:28 says that for those who marry, you will face problems. I mean, that's straight out of the Bible. We are going to hit these high times into where we feel joy and we experience happiness. We're going to hit low moments where there's going to be a lot of pain. And what I love is that there's no one else on earth that I'd rather be with on this grand adventure, not knowing what's around the next corner, what we're going to face. For me, the goal is growing, is growth, not happiness. I want to keep becoming more like Christ. I want to be a better husband. And so my outlook is not happiness, it's growth
okay,
on this journey.
That reality is that's your goal. Sometimes you got to say, okay, I don't feel like being a better husband right now.
Yeah. And there are plenty of times I'm sure Aaron would say, yeah, I experience him that way. And I'm human, and there are going to be those right. moments, and I'm going to go through those seasons where it's about me, I'm selfish, I'm prideful. But at the end of the day, I want to keep growing as an individual and as a husband and having our marriage become a marriage that we are both thrilled with.
So you're looking at the trend line of your life.
Right.
I mean, that's the Christian walk. You want that trend line to be improving over the course of your life, that more of the fruit of the Spirit is who you are over time.
Well, we want to help you grow in your marriage. Let me just tuck in here. One great way for you to do that would be to get a copy of this book, 9 Lies That Will Destroy Your Marriage, written by Bob Paul and Greg Smalley. We've got it at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast or call 800, the letter A in the word family.
All right, Bob, let me throw this one to you, and Greg, you can add on. The second lie, kind of the equation of marriage, and what does it mean? You mentioned that the typical wedding ceremony, which I'm laughing because Gene and I did this, which is the unity candle. It's beautiful.
It
makes sense. It's right out of scripture. I think that, you know, two shall become one. And we did it. We, you know, had two individually lit candles. We lit the one candle, blew the other candles out together. It was beautiful.
I have a tear in my eye.
Yes, I'm glad. Why is that a lie, that the two shall become one? That's right out of scripture.
Yeah, that part's not a lie. The understanding of what is meant by one is the problem.
Okay, give it to me.
Okay, so when you try and become one with Gene, I've known you guys for a while now, and as far as I can see, if oneness, becoming one, is your goal, you two are a failure, because every time I see you, I see still Jim and Gene.
You're right.
Two.
You're not like...
And the problem
attached
is
at the hip.
You're not the same.
And one of the biggest problems is that because in English we use the word one to mean multiple things, in this case to assume it means the number one, we're set up to fail. We can't become the same as one with our spouse. Oneness scripturally is meant to be unity, oneness in spirit and purpose, not the same. And the other thing is that each of us were created by God on purpose with purpose. And each of us have a unique journey together. When you get married, there's me, and there's, in my case, Jenny, and there's us. You add a third journey. And the problem that I see with the unity candle is what you said happens at the end. They blow out the individual candles. And when I'm at a wedding, everything in me wants to stand up and start shouting, which of course would
they'd be disruptive.
They won't invite you back.
How many weddings
we strap him to a chair when he's at a wedding?
Because of that kind of stuff, I hate weddings. I feel at the end of a wedding, I want to go up and hand him my card and say, "You want to hold on to this?"
What's so bad about it? I mean, I hear you saying that blowing it out is signifying that now the old me is gone and we're.
Because the marriage becomes the priority. The marriage becomes the focus. The individuals then sort of fade away into the background. And all we're saying is that all three have to matter. You, your spouse, and your marriage equally all have to matter and have to be attended to.
Well, I think the idea is you become selfless, more selfless. It's natural for human beings to be selfish. That's why the Lord said, be more like me. And he is selfless, right? He's giving. And I think that's the construct of it. Can we give more of ourselves to our spouses rather than take? And Bob, you had an example with you and your wife where vacations were, sounded like a terrible thing, which is horrible that you're vacationing.
I love this example. He hates vacations, weddings.
Here's a practical way you could work through this.
Well, it's because we are, John, fundamentally different. And after almost 40 years of marriage, we are still fundamentally different. So vacations were a common problem for us because my idea of the perfect vacation is hanging out on the beach doing as close to nothing as I possibly can. Jenny is a pedal to the metal kind of gal.
See everything, do everything.
Everything. Okay, before we go on a trip, we have to go get the AAA guide and see where all the gems are between point A and point B, because the more we can do in that amount of time, the better. So
it's good stewardship. Come on.
I end up at the end of a vacation feeling like I need a vacation from the vacation. I'm so exhausted. And Jenny goes stir crazy doing it my way. So we were trying to figure out a way to resolve this, and we prayerfully found a solution. Let's try this. And what we decided to do, and this is just one way to work through things, but it's where our differences became a blessing. We decided to try on a trip to Yellowstone and Grand Teton. We had a road trip for 3 weeks. It was day on, day off. Day on, day off. The day on, we packed as much in as we possibly can. The day off, we just chilled. And what we found, what was so fascinating, is that both of us can overdo our part to an extreme. And I can actually underdo to the point of boredom, and she can overdo to the point of exhaustion. This turned out to be the best vacation we've ever had. And we both ended up refreshed and excited. It was fabulous.
That's great. That's the way it should work. All right. A lot of these love lies seem to be laced with some truth. I think we're identifying that, which can make them kind of hard to distinguish. You know, what we talk about with unity and becoming one seems like the right thing. Hopefully people are understanding your definitions and what the concern is. The third love lie is all you need is love. I want to make sure I attribute that to the Beatles. I think they coined that phrase. But what makes that a lie? It sounds so good. All you need is love. Come on, Greg.
Yeah.
All you need is love.
I just threw up in my mouth a little bit. Hearing you put it quite the way.
I got to say, do-do-do-do-do. Okay, go ahead.
I think the problem is that when it's how people think and define love. So for there's a big group of people that see love as all about that passion, that feeling that they experience, the emotional part of love. And then you've got another group that when they think about love, it's that decision. So there's going to be times you don't feel love and you've got to make that decision. So you find it's kind of those two camps. It's either the focus is on the emotional feeling part of it or the commitment, the decision. And sadly, they completely miss the truth about love, which is God is love. We don't create love. God is love. And when we begin to understand that there's no part of love that I create and generate, it's not about a feeling. It's not just about a commitment. It's understanding that my job is actually to keep my heart open so that God, who is love, flows through me. That's one of the best things that we see happen in an intensive is couples begin to really understand that, okay, so maybe part of the problem is that how I view love. Like we get all the time, couples will come in and just say, well, I don't feel love anymore towards my spouse.
And they think that's the end.
Right.
At that
right.
point, that's the end of their marriage because the love is gone.
Right.
And I'll tell you, the truth is when I'm sitting in the therapist chair at that point, because I understand how love actually works, that's one of the least troubling things anybody can say to me. Because the only reason the love isn't there at that point, since God is love and it all comes from Him, is that somehow the top door to their heart's closed.
Right.
And the love is not able to come through. Because honestly, if we want to experience the fullness of love for our spouse, all we have to do is ask the Lord to let us see through His eyes and feel with His heart. And it will be there in abundance at that point.
That's the golden nugget right there. I mean, that's what it's all about. Greg, you have a story, and sometimes these things can take on small steps. It doesn't have to be something gigantic, although that's good too. But you had a story about just making the bed. I mean, that seems so simple, but it really, it ministered to Aaron, your wife's heart.
Yeah, my wife and I have had this ongoing argument over 20 years of marriage, which is, why do we make a bed? And so we've just battled that, and I kind of finally went, you know, if you want the bed made, go for it. That's your choice. Until she had a foot injury and was in a cast. And I walked into our bedroom and I watched my precious wife in a cast hop around the perimeter of our bed trying to make it. And I said, okay, this is like sick. Like there's, okay, seriously, you're going to injure yourself. It's a bed. Let it go. Take a break. In the course of that discussion, really understanding why that was so important to her and how much that meant to have a bed made, I finally got it.
Yeah.
And thus I realized, you know, that could even be a part of a way that I sacrifice for her, that I invest in my wife, which is really the fourth lie that we see.
Well, I was going to ask you about that exactly, the sacrifice and the misunderstanding of the definition of what it means.
Yeah.
Go ahead and describe it.
Yeah, I think how sacrifice becomes a lie is that we really misunderstand that God has created us with such value. in my sacrifice is actually taking this value that God's given me in using it as an asset, as an investment, as a way to invest in my wife. And so recognizing how important that bed was, in having that bed made was for her, it gave me a choice. I mean, I could either take this investment that God's given me, and actually use that as a way, use the time, use the effort, use the energy that it would take to make the bed every day. And so that day I told her, I said, okay, I get it. Watching you hop around this bed, I get how important this is. I said, from this day forward, I'm doing that. It wasn't sacrificing who I was. It was me taking the gifts who God has made me in and offering that to my wife because of how valuable I see her and understanding my own value.
Well, also, let me turn the table a little. We're four guys sitting at this table, and I want to represent at least Jean, but maybe women listening as well. Because I think women in this perspective, this is tough for them because they believe I have to sacrifice who I am for the sake of my marriage and my husband. So let's put it in that context from a woman's perspective, that sense of sacrifice. I gave up my career for the family. I gave up this. Speak to the need to kind of put that in perspective, how God sees that and what's healthy and unhealthy.
Well, I think giving generously is what sacrifice is about, but it's imperative that we recognize who we are in Christ and that for the gift to be of great value, what's being given must be of great value. So to see yourself as less than in any way actually cheapens the gift when you really get the fullness of who you are and how valuable you are. And then you take that and you invest sacrificially in somebody else. Now you've given something of great value, your time, your energy, your gifts, who you are. And it's imperative that when we sacrifice, when we give sacrificially, it's coming from a place of value, not a place of valuelessness.
But let me press you a little bit. Okay. So at Hope Restored, you're seeing literally hundreds, thousands of couples.
Yes.
How do you prevent that root of bitterness from springing up?
Well, we want everybody that comes to really get who they are in Christ. And we work hard for them to see this is not about you being less than. This is about you being fully who you were created to be. Spread your wings and soar. A great marriage is always one that has room for us to grow into the fullness of who we were created to be and bring all of our gifts to the table.
That's a great place to stop for today. And we're going to come back and cover the other lies in marriage and the truths that will, I think, set you free in your marriage. Greg and Bob, this has been great. Can you come back next time and we'll keep rolling?
Absolutely. You're the boss. So you tell
okay.
us.
Okay, good. I like that. Hey, let me turn to the listeners. I said at the beginning here at Focus on the Family, we want your marriage to thrive in Christ. I mean, that's ideal. If you don't know the Lord, that's job one. We want to talk to you about that. We'd like to introduce you to a relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, Dr. Dobson always said, and I firmly believe this, the staff here believe it as well, we can help you in your marriage. But if we haven't talked about your spiritual dimension, who is the author of marriage, we've kind of failed. So I want to make it clear that we believe a commitment to Christ is fundamental not only to your marriage, but to your life in general, obviously, and to your eternal life. And then from there, it's how do you do this well? And we want to help. I know the pandemic has put extra special pressure on some marriages. Mm-hmm. Some are doing well, given we've had more time to be together, but some are fracturing because of that time together. And we're here for you. Let me also just mention, you put the fuel in the engine here at Focus. So if you haven't supported Focus recently, maybe I could ask you, I'd like to ask you to consider supporting us. And certainly, one of the great ways to do that right now is send a gift of any amount, and we'll send a copy of Bob and Greg's book, Nine Lies. And that will be our way of saying thank you. If I can, let me lean into you because the pandemic has hit us here at Focus too. Giving is slightly down, and we would love to continue to meet a growing need in the marriage and parenting areas, and we need your help now.
Yeah, get in touch today. Our number is 800-A-FAMILY, 800-232-6459. Ask for your copy of Nine Lies That Will Destroy Your Marriage. Donate if you can. And we do have counselors here. We can tell you more about Hope Restored if you're in a spot of pain in your marriage. We want that encouragement we've heard from Bob and Greg to come out to you personally. So call us if we can be of help. Again, the number is 800, the letter A, and the word family. Well, on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.